Hey everyone, my name is Gordon, and I'm a software engineer who helps build apps at Canva.
Hi, I'm Fanglan. I'm a software engineer who also builds apps at Canva.
And welcome to this Canva Developers Talk. For those who are building an app and curious how to scale it, this is going to be the perfect talk for you. And for those who have scaled infrastructure in the past, you may already be familiar with some of these concepts. But stick around, we have some cool stories to tell. Let's get right into it. When you're dealing with the sheer scale of millions of users using Canva apps every month, it can be a real challenge to keep them running smoothly. Today, Fanglan and I are going to explain how we've handled this scale and what you can do too for your apps. For those who don't know, let's briefly cover what a Canva app can do. It can do lots of different things. It can enhance images, generate visual effects using AI, connect users to the tools that they use every day, and much, much more.
When users use our apps, they are delighted to have so much extra power to create and design the things they want. That's why it can be so frustrating when apps stop working, especially when the app gets so popular that it's flooded with more traffic than it can handle. This talk focuses on how to scale your app's backend using AWS, but the same principles and approaches can be easily translated to other cloud providers, such as Google Cloud Platform and Microsoft Azure. For today's agenda, I will kick off with a quick story from one of our developers' experiences to highlight the challenges and surprises that come with scaling an app. Next, we will break down what scaling actually means and why it's so crucial for your app's success. Then we will explore a straightforward and effective way to scale your app backend using AWS Lambda. After that, we will discuss what to do when you need to go beyond Lambda. We will look at other tools and strategies to ensure your app remains robust. And finally, we will wrap things up. Let me share a story to start. One of our app developers created an amazing app that met all requirements to be featured. An app we knew our users would love. We reach out to them with the great news. Hey, your app is going to be featured in our app marketplace. Is your app ready to handle all the new users? You can imagine their reaction, a mixture of excitement and perhaps a hint of nervousness. With confidence, they replied, absolutely, we're ready. So we started to roll out their app slowly. We started small, releasing it to just 1% of our user base. The app performed flawlessly. We upped to 5%, still smooth sailing, then 10%, and everything remained stable. But at just 15 capacity, something changed. Suddenly, we started receiving reports from our support team, complaints from users, and alerts from our monitoring platform. The app crashed. It couldn't handle the surge of traffic node anymore. Of course, the developer sprang into action to diagnose the issue. They dove deep into the server logs, ran stress tests, and finally found solutions. They scaled the app servers, streamlined the process, and reinforced the app architecture. And slowly but surely, the app began to stabilize. I'm happy to say this story ends well for them. And this experience highlights how important effective scaling is. What is scaling? Before we jump into our solutions, let's take a moment to discuss what scaling actually means. Scaling refers to the process of increasing your system's capacity to handle more load, whether that's more users, more data, or more computational power. There are two main strategies of scaling: vertical scaling and horizontal scaling. Vertical scaling, also known as scaling up, involves adding more resources to a single server or machine. This can include increasing the CPU, RAM, storage, or enhancing network capacity. Think of vertical scaling like upgrading your refrigerator. Instead of buying a second fridge, you get a more advanced model that has bigger space and better cooling efficiency for all your food. Horizontal scaling, on the other hand, is known as scaling out, involves adding more nodes to a system essentially distributing the node across multiple servers or instances. You can think of horizontal scaling like adding more lanes to a highway. By widening the route, you allow more cars to travel simultaneously, distributing the traffic to ease the congestion and improving the flow. Similarly, adding more servers helps distribute the workload more effectively. Cloud environments particularly are designed to favor horizontal scaling due to their flexibility and ability to quickly add resources as needed. However, depending on your workload characteristics and application needs, vertical scaling might also be a viable option. Now, let's dive into our solutions. At Canva, we initially decided to run some of our app backends on AWS Lambda. It seemed like the great fit for our needs at the time, and here's why. From the get-go, Lambda offered immense appeal. It's serverless, low self-managed infrastructure, allowing us to focus more on our code and our deliverables. Instead of worrying about things like server maintenance or data source integrations, we can spend more time improving our SDK APIs and building more new apps. Especially during early stages, we had limited resources. One of Lambda's compelling benefits is its cost model. You only pay for the compute time that you actually use. You are billed based on the number of requests for your functions and the duration it takes for your code to execute. This means during the periods of low traffic, you don't have to pay anything when your code is not running. This pay-as-you-go model allowed us to manage our budget more effectively. Then there's Lambda's scaling capabilities. With traffic spikes, Lambda scales out seamlessly by running multiple instances to handle the surge of requests. When traffic now returns to normal levels, Lambda scales in by terminating inactive instances, optimizing cost. It means that we didn't have to anticipate and provision resources manually, reducing the complexity of traffic management. But as with any good story, there was a twist. As our app ecosystem grew, we noticed Lambda's response times were beginning to drag. End users started experiencing noticeable delays sometimes. To pinpoint the root cause, we had to dig deep. We checked our error logs, API response time, and benchmarked the app startup times. Eventually, we identified the culprit, cold starts. A cold start occurs when Lambda function is invoked for the first time or after being idle. Think of it as starting a car on cold morning. The engine takes a few moments to warm up and run smoothly. Similarly, a Lambda function needs time to initialize and prepare for the execution environment, leading to this response latency. To address this problem, we turn to one of Lambda features, provisioned concurrency. It allows you to keep a specified number of function instances initialized and ready to respond. Much like having your car warmed up in the driveway, ready to go at any moment. We explored multiple options while optimizing the static initialization code and adjusting invocation patterns could be good starts, provisioning the concurrency provided the most direct fix for a problem. While provisioning concurrency effectively reduced the code start latency, it also introduced a problem. It adds additional costs. Running your car engine constantly isn't exactly cheap, and neither is keeping those Lambda instances warm. As you know, we should be tuning when we are measuring to make data-driven decisions. We knew what we needed to start looking was observability tools. Luckily, AWS has built-in tools like Amazon CloudWatch. By monitoring and analyzing the real-time data, we regularly reviewed and adjusted the number of warm instances as needed, ensuring we were not over-provisioning. This experience underlines the importance of continuous monitoring and adjustments to balance between performance and cost efficiency. It also highlights the value of adaptability and being proactive about potential scaling issues as your system evolves. Next, Gordon will talk about scaling beyond lambdas.
Thanks, Fanglan. Lambdas sound awesome, and for a lot of cases, they are great. But we have to be aware that there isn't a one-size-fits-all solution. I'm going to show you when you might not want to use Lambda. If your app does more advanced things like audio editing, just be aware that Lambda might have limited or no library support. Lambdas are also not good for when you need a lot of compute. They have limited CPUs and no GPU support at all. This can be particularly a problem for AI apps. This is not saying that you shouldn't use Lambdas. It just might make building and scaling your app backend more awkward if you have more advanced use cases. Luckily, there are some other options. One big category is called container-based compute. Firstly, what is a container and why do you want to use it? Imagine you're trying to ship a bunch of items across the world. All these items are different shapes and sizes. Now imagine trying to stack all of these items onto a ship. Chaos. If only there was a better way of shipping lots of different items. Now it turns out we do have one, and everyone has seen them. Shipping containers. Shipping containers are a marvel of humanity. They enable international trade by standardizing the way that we ship items. Some very smart software engineers took that idea and applied it to software. Apps can have tens to hundreds of dependencies. The big problem is that they don't always run the same way on every machine. Just like shipping all of those different items, we need to be able to ship software in a standard way too. This is what we call containerization. Now that we know why we use containers, how do we use containers? One solution that we use at Canva is AWS App Runner. One key reason to use it over Lambda is that it has a more traditional server model, which makes it easier to integrate with existing applications. We've also found that it scales well to meet the millions of users that we serve each month. Let's see how it does that. It does this by horizontally scaling. Remember, horizontally scaling is increasing the number of instances, whilst vertically scaling is increasing the power of a single instance. But Gordon, you might be asking, isn't that what Lambda does? How's it different? To understand this on a more practical level, let's have a look at the three big numbers that you need to know to scale AWS App Runner. The first number is how many requests each instance can handle. This is usually a fixed number that depends on the app. A web server might be able to handle a few hundred requests at the same time comfortably. But an AI model might only be able to generate a single image at a time. The second number is the minimum number of instances. This is how many machines you want when it's the quietest period of traffic. For Canva apps, this is usually during the US nighttime. This is very similar to Lambda provision concurrency, where we always want to keep a few machines running so that apps can keep running smoothly during the night. And the third and final number is the maximum number of instances. We want to set this to handle the highest amount of traffic. We always like to set it 15 to 20% higher than we expect in case our app gets popular. We don't want to set it too high though, because it can lead to a big bill. We start small and then we bump it up as we need. We found it especially important when we know something big is going to happen to bump it up proactively. For example, if we know our app is going to be featured. App Runner is simple to scale, but it still doesn't fit every use case. For example, it still doesn't support GPUs. But that's okay, because AWS has an even more powerful tool. Let's have a look. It's called autoscaling. There are two main types, application autoscaling and autoscaling groups. The main difference is the types of machines that they can be used with. For now though, we'll focus on the general basics of autoscaling as a whole. To start with, when should you use autoscaling? These forms of advanced autoscaling is most useful when you want to scale on something different than just number of requests. For example, your GPU, your CPU, or much, much more. This can be particularly powerful for AI apps. Let's visualize how this might be better than just scaling on the number of requests. Imagine you're the owner of a big grocery store. We have a register that can serve one customer at a time. In this example, this register represents an AI model, which can only generate a single image at a time, just like how a register can only serve a single customer at a time. Let's see what happens when we try to scale this using the number of requests method. So when a customer comes in, we add in a new register. Okay, not too bad. How about 4 customers? Seems to be fine. After a while though, you start to notice a problem. There are a lot of unused registers. Why do you think that is? The number of requests method makes one big assumption. It assumes, on average, a customer will take the same amount of time and that there won't be a huge difference between customers. Do you see the problem now? That's right. Everyone knows that some customers will take a long time at checkout and some will zip right through. The same is true for AI models. Not all generation requests are the same. A much more sensible approach is to let customers queue for registers. This minimizes the number of registers we need while still serving the customers in a timely fashion. This saves us a lot of money while still making customers happy. We can also queue requests for our app backend using services like Amazon SQS. But how does this all fit into autoscaling? In the real world, we would set up a simple request queue, just like the queues for the registers. In this example, we're using Amazon SQS. We also have an AI model, which in this example can only serve a single request at a time. We can use autoscaling to monitor the length of the queue. When the queue is getting long, we can add more model servers. And when it's short, we can reduce the amount of model servers. This is more flexible than just monitoring the number of requests, since the queue length accounts for tasks that both take a lot more and a lot less time. Now that's all a lot to take in, and you should certainly take your time to think about it. There are so many options that aren't just covered here. So instead of recommending just one, Fanglan and I have a few questions to help guide you to choose for your own app.
So you should be asking yourself these questions.
How many users do you expect? Always add a little buffer to that, maybe 15 to 20%.
What things does your app need to run? Can you use something simple like Lambda? Or do you need something more powerful like App Runner?
Do you need a scale on the number of requests, or queue length, or GPU, or something else?
And finally, remember those 3 big numbers? How many requests can each machine handle? The minimum number of machines and the maximum number of machines. Once you know these answers, you're well on the way to make your app scalable and delightful for our millions of users. Thank you.